on today's show.
The stage is set for All-Star Saturday night, so we'll study the fields and make some early predictions.
Which first-timer will challenge Aaron Gordon? Will Klay Thompson repeat? And is bigs versus smalls a good idea?
And Blake Griffin does a little bit of everything in this week's Top 10 Plays.
It's Friday, February 3rd. The Starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're joining us live right now on NBA TV or later on YouTube, we're very, very happy to have you. I'm Jay Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
Ni hao. Yeah, I was getting his jersey retired.
Nice.
Yeah.
To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the Max Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lately and last, certainly not least, over yonder, yesterday dressed as a groundhog, today a grade 6 math teacher. It's Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
TK, what's poppin'?
Division! Just kidding. I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag TheStarters, and y'all know we love the Jason Williams elbow pass around here. The once-in-a-lifetime dish came in the 2000 Rising Stars Challenge. It made our All-Star Hall of Fame last year, but we're not the only ones to love it. Because last night, White Chocolate showed off the elbow pass in Area 21 after Kenny Smith asked him to demonstrate it. Still got it at age 41. I'm impressed. And it brings us to today's question. What basketball moves need a tutorial? The one I'm trying to figure out right now is Chris Paul's cut dribble or yo-yo dribble. You see John Wall do it all the time too. It's one of the cooler looking moves in the league right now. And while it looks pretty simple, I'm just always confused how they're able to get that much spin on the ball in traffic with guys reaching. But I guess that's why I talk about the NBA rather than play in it.
Yep, fair.
Nonetheless, we want to hear from you, so let us know on Twitter what basketball moves need a tutorial. Send us your best tweets to hashtag TheStarters. We'll hear from you later, and make sure you get your homework in on time already, Phil.
All right, get those tweets in. We got worst of the week. We're going to count down the top 10 plays, although we've cheated once again and made it like the top 12 plays, but who really cares?
Close enough.
But we're starting with a little up, down, right into the report here, where we figure out where the four of us stand on some hot button NBA topics. We ask you to do the same on Twitter as well. Hashtag the Thudders, thumbs up or thumbs down. All right, last night we got our participants in All-Star Saturday night. We start with the dunk contest. Our four dunkers, 2016 dunk contest runner-up Aaron Gordon, new Clippers All-Star DeAndre Jordan, Pacers guard Glenn Robinson III, and my personal favorite, Suns rookie Derrick Jones Jr. Again, our four dunkers. Gordon, Jones Jr. there, Jordan, and Glenn Robinson III. Guys, I want to know, and I'm asking everyone again out there in the Twitterverse, are you up or down on the overall 2017 dunk contest field here? Everybody's up.
Yeah.
Everybody's up despite no Zach LaVine in the mix.
It only takes one to challenge Aaron Gordon. Just one of those three guys, DeAndre, Glenn Robinson, or Derek. They just have to make a great performance. And I know people are worried about DeAndre Jordan being the big, but I feel like, number one, he's got the showmanship. Number two, he's from LA. He's got Blake potentially helping him out.
Sure.
I think he's going to bring it. And he's confident. He's an all-star for the first time. How can he not be confident? I know it's really hard to appreciate 6'11 and 280 pounds because we don't on a night-to-night basis, how he can raise his body like that.
Yeah, but you can find clips of him in layup lines outshining Blake Griffin. He said they used to have dunk contests in layup lines. I've been looking forward to seeing DeAndre in the dunk contest since 2013. He can do things you wouldn't expect from a guy who's 6'11", 280, and it still looks cool because he jumps really high.
Yep. Aaron Gordon wants revenge, even though Zach's not there. He wants this trophy still. So it's going to be great to see him.
A lot of people think he deserved it last year.
He did. I mean, he wasn't a loser as such. Someone had to win, and unfortunately it wasn't him. But if he puts on a show like he did last year, it's going to be very, very hard for one of these other guys to beat him. And I just want to see him again, see what else he's got in that bag of tricks.
Yeah, it's kind of cool to see him as the lead guy this year. He's the guy that everybody's gunning for. We saw six incredible dunks last year. Does he have another six?
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
If he puts on that show, we're all winners. I mean, really we are. And it's nice to see a baby-faced assassin out there too, right? Like, he's just a nice guy. I shook his hand the next day afterward. He's such a nice personality. He's good for the game.
But you're absolutely right, Tess. I think when you say you just need two guys out of however big the field is to really make it a memorable dunk contest. And I think that guy, the second guy with Gordon, of course, who's got to be the favorite, I think it is Derrick Jones Jr., a guy that a lot of people, quite frankly, have no idea who he is because he's only played 11 minutes in the NBA this season, the Suns rookie. A lot of time spent in the D League where some of these unbelievable highlights are coming from. He just is a pogo stick.
Yeah.
He's very, very skinny, obviously. He's speaking as a skinny guy, but I have nothing like those hops. He's just a pogo stick, and I think he's going to shock a lot of people with his athleticism and hopefully his creativity too.
You can present the award to him if he does happen to win, because you've been bigging him up and you've got the skinny bros together.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people are jumping on Twitter because we, in Crossfire, we're making our picks, and I was hoping that he would get in there. People made it seem like I somehow did it. I had nothing to do with that. I was just hoping that he would get in there. So.
Yeah, and Glenn Robinson has all of a sudden become the dark horse, even though he plays in the National Basketball Association, unlike Derrick Jones Jr., and he's had some beautiful dunks this year. But I guess he is the dark horse of the four because he's not getting the rep.
The others,
The plug that Derrick Jones Jr. is.
I think you either, I mean, first off, you must be an unbelievable dunker and the confidence must be high to even go in this because of what happened last year. And I know Zach's not there, but still, we saw what Aaron Gordon did. If you're going up against that, you gotta have some confidence in your abilities to at least not make a fool of yourself. The problem with Derrick Jones Jr. I see a lot of people writing about is like, well, we thought James White a couple years ago was going to be this sudden star because we'd seen all the YouTube clips and all these free throw dunks, and he was a dud. He was a dud in the dunk contest.
That wasn't a great contest at all, that one.
No, it really wasn't. But
he also had like 5 years of hype. Derrick Jones Jr. has about one Crossfire segment, 1 week of hype, really, right?
Yeah. I mean,
he hasn't got a name. James White was, what, 31, I think, when he made it.
It's very true. Yeah, Derrick Jones Jr., obviously a kid still. All right, should be fun. All right, let's move on to the three-point contest field. We got some sharp shooters in this one. Golden State's Klay Thompson, he's going to return to defend his 2016 title. Kemba Walker in the mix. Kyle Lowry in the mix. Yeah, the All-Stars keep coming. Sixth man stud, Eric Gordon. Blazers shooting guard, CJ McCollum. Mavericks guard, Wes Matthews. 2013 three-point champ and All-Star, Kyrie Irving. And I can't believe it happened with Swaggy P himself. Nick
Young. Did it again, man.
Is in there. Yeah, I was hoping he would get in there as well. So there are the eight shooters in the JBL three-point contest. Not bad. I mean, you got some firepower. A lot of these guys are sort of obviously in the top 10 or so of three-pointers made or three-point percentage. Are you up or down, though, on specifically Klay Thompson repeating in this?
Yeah, repeating's hard.
No, I'm up. Whoa. I'm up, boys.
Wow. Why is that?
You look back at the history of this contest, there's been a lot of guys that repeat. That is the honest truth. Now, it hasn't happened for a while. Jason Capono, I believe the last one, back in 07 and 08. But guys like Bird and Hodges and Hornacek and Peja and Mark Price and Capono, it makes sense because you know the flow of the contest, obviously how the whole racks things work. You're not as nervous, I would assume, having been in it.
You're not going to lose your shot.
Yeah, and Klay Thompson, it's just, he's been incredible the last 2 years he's been in it.
Yeah.
In fact, I went back and like looked at his results. He's done four rounds, right? Because he's done two first rounds and two finals in the 2 years he's been in it. He's averaged 21.8. That's very, very high. If you hit 22 or 21, you would have won the 2014 finals, 2012, 2011, 2010, 2009.
Well, he's unbelievable. Slightly different, though, because the Moneyball rack came in a couple of years
ago. I get that. But I'm not betting against Klay. I'm not betting against
Klay. Predicting is too hard in this contest. Yeah. I'm taking Wes Matthews. I don't really have anything to go on. I like the fact, though, he's a compact shooter, unlike a Lowry or a Kemba, who really jump basically from outside the three-point line to inside the three-point line, have to get back, sort of like a J.J. Redick that we've seen in the contest, or Lowry last year. Wes, compact, boom, doesn't jump too much, done.
A flinch. Yep.
I'm going with Kyrie Irving. He won it before.
He has.
He's been in the final one other time.
Yeah.
He missed it last year because of injury. This is what I like. He could have easily sat out this time as well. As a former winner, you're like, you know what, I don't want to go in it. I'm going to be in the game anyway.
He's got a gold medal and a title already.
Exactly. So he's got plenty. But he's coming back because he wants to win this again. And that's what I really like about him. I love his stroke. He's beautiful every time he shoots the ball. 38% shooter. And also, his favorite spot is that spot where he hit the Game 7 winner last year against the Warriors. He shoots 46%
on the right side there.
So that's where his money ball rack, in my opinion, is likely to be. That's where he's going to clean up.
Should be good. This is usually one of the better events. I mean,
everybody in is a great shooter,
you can't
so
mess
anybody
up.
Can
yeah.
win, right? So
yeah,
if you
exactly,
have one
yeah.
off rack, somebody sneaks in with 25, now you got a finals where Marco Bellinelli's winning. You wouldn't expect
that's
that.
That's right. Yeah. We've seen the dunk contest sort of have extreme lows and extreme highs. This is pretty steady, the three-point contest. Mm-hmm. Usually pretty good. All right, final one here, guys. The skills challenge. We're sticking with the bigs versus the smalls. Kristaps Porzingis, DeMarcus Cousins, Anthony Davis, and Joel Embiid are on Team Big. And the smallies, very small, Isaiah Thomas, Devin Booker, sort of a big small, Gordon Hayward.
Medium.
And John Wall. This is, of course, a test of speed and ball handling and shooting. And there again, it's a bracket, so it's the bigs versus the bigs on one side, the smalls versus the smalls on the other, and then in the finals we get the both the big and the small going against it.
It was great last year.
Well, that was going to be my question. Are you happy with the NBA sticking with the bigs versus smalls format of this skills challenge?
Oh, you've got to.
Everybody's
got to.
I think the challenge for the bigs comes in shooting that three-pointer off the dribble, because that's probably not a lot of those bigs do that. They're sort of more catch and shoot, get into position. So that is going to test them out. But of course, last year, Karl Anthony Towns won it. So against Isaiah Thomas. So even though it probably favors the smallies, the biggies, they want this because there is a little bit more camaraderie and there's a bit more of teamwork.
And the bigs need something on All-Star weekend. We don't have the center spot in the All-Star game anymore. Everybody doesn't think big guys are good in the dunk contest.
Yeah.
3-point shootout, all guards for the most part. Mm-hmm. Let the bigs do something. These guys are super skilled nowadays.
Yeah, that's for sure. And you're right. It usually comes down to the 3-point shot. So we crunched the numbers here of the 8 guys we got in it, the bigs and the smalls. These are the numbers from this year. And it's pretty close.
I know, what a great photo.
That's awesome.
The bigs shoot 36.4% from 3. And, you know, the smalls a little bit better at 37%. But you're right, it's one thing to sort of catch and shoot, another to sort of be going full steam and knock it down.
We just got to hope for Kristaps versus Isaiah Thomas in the finals. The tallest versus the smallest, that'd be beautiful.
Yeah. Speaking of bigs and smalls, I heard Faith Evans is coming out with an album with Biggie Smalls. Duets.
CNN,
Biggie Smalls,
they said Faith Hill at one point. Said Faith Hill, and then they had to correct it. Faith Evans makes a lot more sense than Faith Hill. All right, we got lots more still to come on the show tonight. When we come back, TASS awards the Dishonor for Worst of the Week. Chucky highlights, interesting.
Welcome back to the show. Now's the point of the week where we hand out the Dishonor to someone in the NBA family that has done wrong in the eyes of the starters. It's time for the Worst of the Week.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Worst of the Week.
This week's Worst of the Week is TNT's Inside the NBA crew, because the moisturizer mystery remains unsolved. Recently, Enes Kanter broke his forearm punching a chair on OKC's bench, and he's out 6 to 8 weeks because of it. It was a weird one, and that got the TNT crew talking Monday about the strangest injuries they've ever suffered during their careers. Here's Ernie Johnson asking Chuck about his.
Chuckster. Strangest injury.
Eating donuts.
I think that when Sean
Bradley
kicked me.
No, that's not your strangest injury.
No, it is not. Here are a couple actual broadcasts from opening night in 94 outlining Chuck's oddest, air quotes, injury.
Charles Barkley, of course, not playing after getting that hand lotion or body lotion in his eyes at the Eric Clapton concert. What's the story to tell?
The Phoenix Suns took their act to Sacramento tonight, but Charles Barkley didn't even put in a cameo. Barkley sat out the game in part because of his strained stomach muscle and because he mildly burned his corneas by accidentally rubbing lotion in his eyes during an Eric Clapton concert.
A young Ernie Johnson and Bob Lorenz. All right, so we're going to get to the bottom of this bomb blunder. Let's get the answer we need.
You had lotion in your eye and you couldn't play?
When did you put the lotion?
Why were you at a concert with lotion?
Exactly.
It was all my hair.
What? The segment was madness. We never truly found out what happened. One of America's greatest unsolved mysteries remains unsolved. Why? Although, we did get this great moment from Kenny.
Zach, I'm just trying to figure out, like, you had a concert. You're like, hey,
I can't say.
Who does that?
The Inside the NBA crew, your worst and also your best of the week. Now, we didn't get the answer we were looking for.
Yeah,
I mean, we didn't really get a full explanation, but Chuck provided this hilarious moment because he is Charles Barkley.
When I got home, I couldn't see. I had to call. I couldn't see. Y'all joking around, man. I was blind. I was blind for like 3 hours, Ernie.
I don't know. I wanted an answer.
You ever get a lotion in your eye?
No, but I do wear it every night. I'm a little more cautious with it.
Yeah,
oh,
now
really?
after that story,
yeah.
Right? Yeah.
You ever been to an Eric Clapton concert?
No, but I would love to. He's great. Yeah.
Bon Jovi, you got a Bon Jovi concert coming up.
Bon Jovi next week.
Well, be careful with the lotion on your head. Don't do that.
Oh,
actually, do that.
Wait.
Get it all worked in. There you go.
All right. My hands are clean and smooth.
A fascinating worst of the week. One. That's great. When we come back, when we return, we're printing mad posters in this week's top 10 plays from the past 7 days. Don't go anywhere. Back with the starters, White Chocolate showing off the elbow pass in Area 21 last night. So we asked you what basketball move needs a tutorial. You hit us up on Twitter, #StartersTrey. Trey.
Yeah, some great answers. And this was by far the most suggested. The Sham God is definitely a move I would love to learn. About 100 people tweeted that in. That's a tough one. This comes from Inside Hoops. It says, all big men should receive tutorials on the hook shot, the most unguardable yet underutilized move in basketball. You're preaching to the choir. My favorite answer came from This Day in Suck, Kent Bazemore.
Oh, yeah.
Baze gaze. Luckily, we have a baze gaze expert here, Lee Ellis. Hit him with that baze gaze.
Oh, what are you doing with your
weirder
face
this year?
Oh, man.
You just got some lotion in it.
All right, keep the tweets coming. Let's get to the top 10 plays from the past 7 days at number 10. Norm! Norman Powell.
Oh, yeah.
Blows by Anthony Davis on the perimeter, and then
it's a pretty gutsy dunk to go straight at AD.
I'll
like
say.
That.
Nice first step
Popped
there.
In.
Gets a bio.
Quick dunk.
Nav liked it.
Yep.
At number 9, Kyrie Irving. I consider this him just having some fun, you know?
Having a larf.
Yeah, having a larf.
Almost like he heard the whistle as if the play didn't count and just did
Exactly. Yeah. He did not need to do that second move, but he figured, you know what? I'm playing around here.
Yeah.
Look at the English. At number 8, let's stick with the sexy layups here. Kawhi Leonard is going to cross up Oladipo. Bye. And then the up and under left hand.
Layups are back!
And one.
What a week for layups.
It's Jordan-esque a little.
Whoa, whoa.
A little.
Easy. It is. At least Dwayne Wade-esque.
Yes, okay. I can see that. That's gorgeous from Kawhi at number 8.
At number 7, we squeezed in a couple chase down blocks.
All right.
Because we love basketball. Russ doesn't have it there, so he gets it back.
Oh, yeah. Pop.
Gets Jimmy Butler the chase down.
Turnover to the block.
Very, very nice. And then Bradley Beal, a guy you don't know for blocking shots. Mm-hmm. But he gets D'Angelo Russell there with a swat.
Holy moly.
Yeah, that's real ball. Deal.
Bang. Get out. Get out. All right, from two blocks to two dimes. Nicholas Batum with the
man
unbelievable pass to Marco Bellinelli. Trey.
Technical alley-oop. It's a spicy one.
There you go. Great pass. And also at number 6, Blake Griffin. Around the back between the legs to the cutting JJ Redick.
Smooth.
With the smooth. Up and under.
It's a great angle, that.
Yeah, that's a power forward. Just dropping it between his legs.
At number 5, this Kristaps Porzingis jam is a huge one, but the collision was also huge. I was 6 rows back, you could hear Kristaps' body hit the floor, but he popped right back
up. I'm okay.
Totally fine.
Yeah, looked like the Undertaker popping up right there.
Okay. You forget that he's 5 inches taller than Dwight.
That's
he's way bigger.
Huge. At number 4, back to Blake Griffin. Not a dime this time, but a dunk. Makes more sense from Blake. Yeah, he's gonna baptize Kevin Looney here. Watch, he puts his left hand on his head. And gives us a little old school Blake, really.
Yeah, haven't seen him for a while.
Splays the legs and everything.
At number 3, we call this the snub slam, because after the All-Star reserves were announced, Joel Embiid's first possession. His first game, his first possession, he threw it down on Nene. A monstrous, a lefty dunk too.
Nene's like, I'm not Paul Millsap, man. You don't need to dunk on me. I make it in the East. I play in the West, for crying out loud. At number 2, Andrew Wiggins is going to fly. He just soars. I love his dunks.
Yeah.
They're all sort of similar this.
Yeah, 2-footed jump.
Oh my.
He moves so fast in the air.
Yeah. It's crazy. He dunks around guys.
And at number 1, not around a guy, but on a guy. Paul George.
Oh.
Right on Flint.
Doinks him in the head with the ball, even.
Pulls right at him.
Yeah, that's vicious. There's some anger to that dunk.
He wanted the foul, too.
Probably should have got it. There you go. Top 10 plays of the week. Agree, disagree, let us know on Twitter, #TheStarters. Final break here, but when we come back, Lili hits us with his very solid play. Last night's pick 'em results, it was the Warriors and the Clips. We all had the dubs, and they all got the W, so there's our scores for the month of February right now. It's early, of course. Tonight's picks. Well, Tass, the only one taking the Thunder at home. Everybody else taking those Grizzly Bears.
You're betting against Russ?
Yeah, Thunder on a bit of a slide right now without Cantor in there. So we will see. All right, Lili, where are we going for VSP?
I know it was Groundhog Day yesterday, but with the Spurs, when it comes to very solid play, it could be every day. It's just a classic boomerang.
Oh, yeah.
Started by Danny, ended by Danny in the corner for our
switch button. Whoa, not quite.
Yeah, that wasn't quite a switch.
You misled us.
Yeah, I did. But look at this ball movement. This is what I love. Bounce passes, ball fizzing around. Ends where it started. That's what I call a very solid play.
Good stuff.
Those thumbs look smooth.
We had some fun recording the Drop podcast this morning. It's up on iTunes and Google Play. We discussed the Bucks-Hornets trade, Magic Johnson returning to the Lakers, and the guys had some fun answering this rapid-fire question. The Young Waiters has come up huge for the streaking Miami Heat as of late, and this week the City of Brotherly Love native claimed he was playing with, quote, that Philly cheese swag. That Philly cheese swag, he said. Guys, how would you describe your swag?
El Greco swag.
Trey.
I got that long neck swag.
Lee.
Suck a daddy swag.
I'd watch that.
Giancarlo and his girlfriend at the Celtics-Raptors game the other night. Nice job there, guys. Vincent and his buds in Cleveland with a four-man effort.
Nice job there.
Nice sign, guys.
Amos's son in Brooklyn with a very, very nice job there.
That looks like it's a pizza box.
Is that a pizza box?
Yeah, maybe. That's fine. That's creative. That's okay. McKinley Sims.
Oh, come on.
Sounds like a Simpsons character. This is unusual yet imaginative,
That looks like a phone for
that's
kids.
A phone.
Yeah, that's all right. And we end where we started, back in Boston for the Celtics-Raptors games, and it's Derek who put together that sign. Thank you, everybody. Keep them coming.
Keep those fan signs coming. Tweet them in. Hashtag the starters. Before we go here, gotta get it on the record. Falcons, Patriots, Super Bowl 51.
Yes, the Falcons!
Dirty Birds? I know the crew wants the Dirty Birds to rise up and land out there. But you don't even care.
My Falcons, baby.
You're just pumped about Lady Gaga.
Oh, yeah, Lady Gaga. Halftime show.
Oh, yeah.
There he perks up.
He's a little monster.
Yeah.
These guys are pumped out there.
All right, thanks for joining us, folks.
Yeah.
Go Falcons!
Ricky.
And remember, the Bay's gaze can be performed with glasses.
Embrace the Super Bowl, people.